Cell membrane is like the guardian of the cell. It only allows certain substances to pass through. However, how can cell membranes regulate the substances into and out of the cells? In today's video, we will have a look at the movement of substances into and out of the cells. Unlike most other videos on YouTube that only discusses the overall concept, this video will also discuss the background chemistry behind, the importance and factors affecting the rate of diffusion, osmosis, active transport, and phagocytosis. To begin with, we have to look at the overall structure of the cell membrane, as it is quite difficult to understand how substances move across the cell membranes without knowing the structures. Cell membrane is differentially permeable, meaning it only allows certain substances to pass through. According to the fluid mosaic model, cell membrane is mainly made up of phospholipid molecules, which are arranged in bilayer and can move laterally like a fluid, and proteins, which are interspersed among the phospholipid molecules in a mosaic model. Proteins are attached to the surface of bilayer, embedded halfway in the bilayer, or span the entire bilayer. On some of the proteins, carbohydrates are attached to some of the protein molecules to form glycoproteins. Let's have a look at the feature of phospholipid molecules. A triglyceride molecule is hydrophobic, made of glycerol and three fatty acids. However, in phospholipid molecule, one of the fatty acids is replaced by the phosphate group. Since the phosphate group is polar, the head of phospholipid molecule is hydrophilic, meaning water-loving. The tail will continue to be hydrophobic, meaning water-hating. But why will it be water-loving? Consider a water molecule. There are hydrogen atoms and oxygen atoms. Oxygen and hydrogen both share electrons. Oxygen has 8 protons, so it attracts the shared electrons more. So on the side of hydrogen, that will be more positive, and on the side of oxygen, it will be more negative. This is a polar substance. A polar substance likes a polar substance. A non-polar substance likes a non-polar substance. As the phosphate group is polar, the head of phospholipid molecule will be polar. They like water as water is a polar substance. So if we have a look at the structure of the cell membrane, the hydrophilic head points outwards, pointing to the extracellular fluid containing water and also the cytoplasm containing the water. Proteins are also present in cell membrane and they have different functions. Channel proteins and carrier proteins have functions that are related to the transport mechanism we will have to discuss later on. Receptors bind to chemical messengers outside the cells to turn on certain activities. Antigens are glycoproteins to recognize the cells. Enzymes speed up chemical reactions, that in fact, we have a complete video talking about how enzymes can speed up the chemical reactions. Small nonpolar molecules like oxygen, carbon dioxide, glycerol will move by dissolving in the phospholipid bilayer. Small polar molecules like water, urea, and amino acids will be repelled by the phospholipid bilayer. So they are transported by carrier proteins, except water, and small ions like sodium ions and also water will be transported by channel proteins. Large molecules cannot move through the cell membrane. There are some factors affecting the permeability of the cell membrane. At higher temperature, the phospholipid molecule gain more kinetic energy and pack less closely together. Substances move across phospholipid bilayer more easily, so the permeability increases. Organic solvents can dissolve phospholipids and damage the membranes. This increases the permeability. Why is the cell membrane fluid in nature? Well, it allows cell membranes to change shape and fuse with one another. That is important in phagocytosis, something we'll talk about later in this video, and cell division, something we'll cover in another video. There are 4 major transport mechanisms of substances across membranes, not only limited to cell membranes. That includes diffusion, osmosis, active transport, and phagocytosis. Diffusion is the net movement of particles from the region of higher concentration to the region of lower concentration, or we can call that down the concentration gradient, until an equilibrium state is reached. There are some factors speeding up diffusion. The steeper the concentration gradient, the higher the rate of diffusion. Some of you may be wondering what it means by the concentration gradient. In fact, it's the difference in concentration of the two areas. The steeper concentration gradient refers to a larger difference. Therefore, the larger the difference in concentration of solid, the higher the rate of diffusion. The larger the surface area, the shorter shorter distance, higher temperature, smaller particles, and substances being nonpolar, the higher the rate of diffusion.
Importance of diffusion. It allows exchange of materials between the environment and the cells, so useful substances, such as oxygen, can go into the cells, while wastes, like metabolic wastes of carbon dioxide, can leave the cells. Diffusion is also involved in many life processes, including the absorption of nutrients in the human small intestine and the gas exchange in the human lungs.
Osmosis is the net movement of water molecules from a region of higher water potential to a region of lower water potential across a differentially permeable membrane. Water potential refers to the tendency of water molecules to move. The higher amount of the solid particles in a solution, the higher the concentration of the solution. The higher the concentration of the solution, the lower the tendency of the water molecules to move. The low tendency of water molecules to move can be described as having low water potential. Sounds complicated? Let's have a look at the following diagrams. In the pink box, the concentration of solid, the red one, is higher than that in the green box. Diffusion of solid molecules from higher concentration to lower concentration may sometimes be impossible, due to the large sizes of solute particles. However, we need to make the concentration the same. Therefore, by adding water molecules from the green box to the pink box, we can make the concentration and water potential the same. Now the water potential and concentration are the same, so there will be no more net movement of water molecules. Now, what will be the effect of the concentration of solid particles outside the cells? Before discussing that, let's have a look at what is hypotonic, isotonic and hypertonic solution. Hypotonic refers to low concentration in surrounding solution, means a high water potential in surrounding solution. Isotonic solution refers to the solution having the same concentration and same water potential of that inside the cells. Hypertonic solution is the solution with higher concentration compared with cells and lower potential compared with cells. Hypotonic solution has a high water potential, so therefore when the cell is placed in the hypotonic solution, there will be a net movement of water molecules into the cells. The animal cells may swell and finally burst, while in plant cells, due to the presence of cell wall, it will only become turgid. There will be no net movement of water and no observable change in animal and plant cells when the cells are placed in isotonic solution. There will be a net movement of leaving the cell in hypertonic solution. The animal cells will shrink and become wrinkled, and the plant cells may be flaccid and plasmolyzed. The cell membrane will be partially detached from the cell wall. The table summarizes the effect of hypotonic, isotonic, and hypertonic solutions on cells. Osmosis is important as it is the main mechanism by which water enters and leaves cells. For example, the absorption of water in human intestines and the return of water from tissue fluid into the capillaries. To learn more, at the venous end of capillaries, due to the retention of plasma proteins and low hydrostatic pressure in the venous end of capillaries, the water potential is lower. Therefore, the water molecules will move from tissue fluid into the capillaries by osmosis. Active transport is the transport mechanism by some of the carrier proteins to help move substances from a region of lower concentration to a region of higher concentration, and energy is needed in this process. Cells with high rates of active transport usually have a high respiration rate, as respiration is needed to provide energy for active transport. And there's also a large number of mitochondria, as mitochondria helps carry out respiration. As there's a close relationship between active transport and the need of mitochondria, conditions that lower the rate of respiration will decrease the rate of active transport. Low temperature, low oxygen concentration, and having respiration inhibitors, such as cyanide, which inhibits mitochondrial oxidative phosphorylation. Active transport enables cells to take up additional useful substances that are already high in concentration in the cells. And active transport is involved in different processes in organisms, such as absorption of nutrients and absorption of minerals from the soil. Phagocytosis is the uptake of large particles into the cells by the process of packaging the particles into vacuoles that are formed from the cell membrane. First, pseudopodia will be formed to surround the particle to be taken in. Cell membrane fuses to form a vacuole to enclose the particle. Afterwards, the vacuole containing the particle taken in will fuse with other vacuoles that contain digestive enzymes. With the help of enzymes, the particle is broken down and digested. They are absorbed into the cytoplasm. Unicellular organisms engulf food particles so that it's important for the nutrition. Humans have white blood cells that engulf harmful microorganisms for body defense. So, in conclusion, we've covered three main things. First, the structure of the cell membrane illustrated by the fluid mosaic model. Second, the part of the cell membrane that different substances pass through. And third, the transport of substances across membranes, including diffusion, osmosis, active transport, and phagocytosis.